Okay, so what is that we can do now? Let us actually begin it, respecting the people who have joined on time. Anyway, in the meantime, people will be joining the webinar. So maybe, you know, Subramanyam and Arjun, like probably you can tell, no, so what are all your high level expectations from this particular webinar? Probably you can you can just share a line or two.
Sir, Subramanyam here.
Yeah.
Sir, usually the questions in interview for Scrum Master is something like, you already know, but I just like to quote, means what you are expecting or why would you like to join the organization? Okay. This is the basic question every person will get. I just want to get the best answer so that we can face it very easy.
Sure, sure. So, but then, no, one second.
Able to talk.
Okay, maybe for him, I'm not sure, but I'm just allowing the people as and when they join the webinar to talk, but they can be on mute for now. Okay, so Subramanyam, so what we can do, now, some kind of questions we may need to see whether it is purely related to Agile or a Scrum or a general interview question, because those kind of question what you are trying to now ask now is been independent of the role.
Yes, sir. Understood.
So you may need to prepare. We will see as part of the webinar. And any other people wanted to share their expectations from this particular webinar, you can yourself unmute and then talk. Vivek had joined, Vikas had joined, Nibedita, Balamurugan. Okay. Any kind of expectations from this particular webinar, someone need to talk?
Hello.
Yeah, hello. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Vikas here. I wanted to know on if I'm joining a new organization as a master sister. So I might need to start a team. So on some light on that part also.
Okay. So Vikas, so what I'll do now, of course, I do have the slides ready, but then before we get into the slides, no, in the meantime, people join. I'm just sharing my screen. Are you able to see?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, one second. So, 1 minute. Let it come. It's like, see, my 1 minute. So here on my YouTube channel, I'm not sure whether you know that I have a YouTube channel. On my YouTube channel, if in one of the video, I have exactly discussed this for 30 minutes. Probably you can go through that particular video.
Sure. I have subscribed, but I have not gone.
Yeah, so what I'll do is let it load. I will exactly show you which particular video. If you go to video section here, 1 minute. Probably you can start watching this particular video, how to create an agile coaching plan. Probably this particular video will give you some kind of indicators. And one more video, Balaji's view on areas to focus as a Scrum Master or as an agile coach when you onboard onto your new team.
Right? Okay, sure.
So this particular video could be, this particular team could be either within your same organization or you are joining a different organization, because the team is been new to you, no? Okay, so it doesn't matter whether it's a new client within the same organization or you are joining altogether different organization. Fundamentally, from the team perspective, it is a new team to you. So probably you can take some pointers from that.
Okay. Sure. Thanks a lot.
Okay, I think someone raised their hand. Who is that, please? Someone raised their hand.
Hi, Balaji. This is Avita.
Yeah.
Yeah, my question was, I was more looking at how to influence people in a Scrum team where I don't have, like, I work in a multi-vendor team. So It's like I don't have an authority, but still to influence people and get the job done.
Okay, so we will see as part of the webinar, but then to quickly give you some pointers based on my experiences, probably you may need to find some kind of a common KRAs, come some kind of a common KRAs or some kind of a common KPIs between the teams. So the point is, rather than directly trying to influence the team, objective is to add value to the team, because the moment you start solving the team's pain point and you start adding some value to the team in terms of taking some training sessions or creating some templates and then giving it to them, and then, you know, probably defending the team in front of the client leadership and the management, something like that, if you start doing, probably you may try to get a better rapport with the team first, and then influencing the team could be of a sustainable manner. Okay, see, once in a while influencing the team is something different. Maintaining a rapport and then getting things done in a sustainable manner is actually something different, right? So probably there actually should be some kind of a change management process, which also need to be, you know, which also need to be introduced within the team. So we will see as part of the webinar. So in the meantime, people, if you have whatever questions come to your mind, you can start putting it in the chat. Okay. So when we go through the slides, and then when we come to the chat, I have dedicated anywhere 45 to 50 minutes only to answer to your questions. So you can start putting your questions in the chat. Probably I will complete few of the slides, and then we can actually pick up the questions from the chat. Okay, is that okay for you people?
Yes, yes, sir.
Yeah.
Okay, fine.
Thank you.
Okay, so what we'll do, I have some slides prepared here just to begin the journey. We will just try to quickly go through the slides, and then we will come back to the, because the point is like this, any kind of an interview preparation, it is not just getting answers to that particular question. One need to know the context behind the question, right? And for you to know the context behind the question, you need to understand what are all the slippery, the path or the road? What are all the potential pitfalls which you may encounter whenever you are preparing for an interview? So we can start from some of the pain points, and then we can get into the answering mode of the questions. Okay, so one second, I'll just put it in a thing. Okay. So this is a quick introduction about myself, like in terms of my years of experience, my Agile experience, and my educational qualifications, and where am I currently, like in terms of my roles and the responsibilities. And these are all some of the clients with whom I have basically worked in the past. Respecting that, you can read it. I'm not going to read it in a verbatim manner. You can just take a look into the slide. Now let us jump to the second slide. Okay. So in this particular webinar, I have tried to orchestrate the flow of the webinar in this particular points. What are all the challenges? What will happen if we stop learning? What could be the probable way, the solution point of view to overcome these particular challenges? And once we are done with these three slides, we can probably get into answering some of the questions, and then we will go on the do's and don'ts and all. Okay. So see, these are all some of the challenges which actually came to my mind as an interview panel member, and also as a candidate for an interview when I was actually preparing for the interview. First thing could be the JD is not very clear, because nowadays when you go through the JD, what do they exactly want? Do they want a Scrum Master, or they want a project manager, or they want a PMO kind of a role, which has not been very clear? Because if you go through the JD, many companies, they wanted one person to do multiple roles. So we are not very clear in terms of the weightage, percentage distribution of the topics, like whether you need to prepare more on project management concepts, or you need to prepare more on this Scrum framework, or where exactly do you need to put your effort? So the second point is, how do I need to distribute my effort in terms of a preparation across multiple topics? Okay, some candidates may have some challenges, right? I know the concept theoretically, but I don't know how to implement it. Say, for example, dynamic budgeting at a portfolio level. If you do Safe Agilist certification, you will come to know about the lean portfolio management. So you know on a higher level, what do you mean by dynamic budgeting? Unfortunately, you have not got an opportunity to do it. So you don't know how to practically get it done. Okay, that actually could be some of the challenges. Some people come to me, like when I do a JD based coaching, some people come to me and then they ask me some kind of questions like whether I need to give a truthful answer to a question or do I need to give some kind of a diplomatic answer to your question. Because see, for example, now that particular interviewer is asking you, okay, how do you analyze the a burn down chart, or how will you interpret a CFD, something like that they are asking, where you know only partial answer or only the high level answer. If you directly tell them, I have never analyzed a burn down chart, it's a straight rejection. But if you tell that I have analyzed, then probably the second level question will be to justify it, right? So what you say in an interview, we need to be very careful, because from that, the second level and the third level questions are actually going to come. So there will be a mental dilemma up to what to conceal, what need to be transparent. Okay, let us talk practically. Now, though we say that Agile has focus, courage, all the transparency, not always transparency will give you success or a positive, the positive outcomes, particularly in an interview context. So some people will have that particular mental dilemma, okay? And these are all some of the other challenges. Say, for example, last week I was actually talking to one person, and that person was saying that he had already cleared the interview and he is serving the notice period, but he is having the fear, the fear factor or the uncertainty. Once I join a company, once that person joins the company, will I be able to justify what I told in the interview? Okay. So possibly these are all some of the glimpses of the challenges. And some guy came to me and then told that he has worked at a team level and to some extent at a program layer. Probably if they're asking anything hands-on on a portfolio level, maybe that person may not be able to do it on the ground. Okay. And the other question what I had is, see, now why actually much of the people now struggle to clear an interview is, in sometimes for you to do that role, first you need to be in that position to do that role. And for you to go to that position, you may need to clear the interview first. So actually what happens, it is like a catch-22 situation. You can start this only if this is completed, and you can start this only if this is completed. So it creates a deadlock kind of a situation. Okay. So see, these are all my own thoughts. Okay. It's not like what I took from Google or anywhere. Practically, when I speak to multiple people, maybe as part of my mentorship program or in my client circle, these are all some of the challenges which people have told me. I have created a survey and then I have collected answer, consolidated, removing the duplicates. Okay, and then I try to paraphrase it here. And one more main thing is, unfortunately, many of you, most of us, right? All of us have managers in our organization, but managers are not playing the role of a mentor. Managers are not playing the role of a coach whenever they wanted to guide us. Generally, managers come to us and then ask, hey, what happened to the task? Okay, had you completed it? Something like that. Now let me stop sharing the screen for a moment. Now, what you people felt on these slides, did it make relevance to you, or you want to add anything or comment anything on some of the challenges? In the meantime, I'm actually allowing the people to talk who had joined now. Yeah, go ahead.
I felt, sir, most of the real-time scenario questions and what you have put on presentation. Because I have seen few people that they clear the interview. When it comes to the practical working environment, there might be some factor hidden in mind, because it is a new team and a new environment or a new company. So I believe maybe that phobia is one thing which should be removed.
Let me tell an example. Many years back, when I was working as a scrum master, I was actually conducting the scrum ceremonies and all. Okay, I have in fact told this in that video also. What happened is that suddenly my client manager, because my client manager is actually giving me the billing. Okay, at that time I was actually somewhere in 2013 or 12 kind of a thing I'm saying. So at that time, what happened? Suddenly he will ask me, okay, had you, Balaji, had you, invited the UAT guys for this demo? Had you invited this team for a demo, that team for a demo? And he will not give me any heads up. And I was performing the role of a scrum master, okay, first time there. Of course, I played the role of a project manager, program manager, and a non-functional test manager. But that particular scrum master role was a bit new to me, okay? Somewhere in 2011 or 12 kind of time. At the time, if you tell that, if you use the word velocity, burn up chart, burn down chart, you will get offer letters. Because at the time, the scrum masters were not so flooded as of now, okay? So what happened, client manager will be asking in front of all. And sometimes this client manager used to pass some sarcastic comments also. For example, if in case we have some operational challenges that a laptop is not working or anything like that, they can raise a ticket to the IT support. It is not Scrum Master's responsibility to track and solve those kind of impediments. Impediments does not mean everything under the sun. Impediments which are related to the sprint goal or the flow of the user stories. Of course, if the laptop is a problem, there is a way to get it done. You cannot put it on the Scrum Master. And suddenly questioning and passing some sarcastic comments, no. I used to feel a little bit embarrassed, okay, in front of the entire team, okay. So then I used to, you know, do a lot of retrospectives, and then I went to some mentors, then I started reading white papers, I started writing blogs, I started participating in Agile meetups and conferences. So like we all know, what we read in our college days is not going to help us now, but that reading habit is going to help us. What you read in our schools and college days is not going to help us directly on the job, but that reading mindset or mentality to continuously improve, okay, that is going to help. So these are all some of the challenges, so what I thought. Okay, so before I share the screen once again, one second. I'll just take the current slide. Okay. 1 minute. Yeah. Once again, share it. Okay. So here, if you see, what will happen if we stop learning? Probably we need to ask this particular question. If we stop learning, these are all the detrimental impacts. Okay. By and large, we may become obsolete because market is not going to wait for us. Market is not going to wait for anyone for us, right? Including myself. The second thing, if I'm not learning, if I'm not getting into the habit of continuous learning, I am increasing the probability to fail. It could be failure in the interview, or it could be failure in the real-time implementation of the project, okay. Third thing is, nowadays, it is becoming too tough, believe me. Somewhere in 2014 or 15 itself, clearing client interviews within the same company itself became a challenge, because much of the project managers, let's say in 2014, I was actually working for an initiative, and we were not getting scrum masters and agile coaches for some of our client. So what these guys used to do, they used to take the project managers, give them some 3 to 4 days of training on this on the Scrum, Kanban, DevOps basics, and then they position them as a Scrum Master. If we are sending 20 people, only 2 or 3 will get selected. The remaining 17, 18 will get rejected. So forget about getting a job outside. Even within the same organization, if you want to go to some other client, you need to clear the client interview, right? Even clearing client interview demands you to learn continuously. As obvious, everyone has their own financial commitments and burdens. Even to look out for a job, or if you want to do something, even if you're taking a resume writing service, or even if you're taking a cover letter writing service, you actually need to spend some money for it, right? So even to look out for a good job, probably you may need to spend money. And most important thing, forget about all these things. Tomorrow, when we are joining in a particular project, if we are not having the subject knowledge, the team members will not respect us. Because I have seen this in many of the transformation, when we are putting a scrum master, and if the scrum master is not able to understand some technical details, see, we are not expecting the scrum master to sit and write a Jenkins CI/CD pipeline code, but a scrum master should understand, what do you mean by an enabler? What is an architectural runway? What is a Docker container? what is a Kubernetes, what do you mean by a microservice, what do you mean by a REST API call service. Simple technical vocabulary, the meaning of it, the context of it should be understood by a Scrum Master. Suppose if the Scrum Master is not able to have that conversations, I have seen practically the team members will not respect. It is not only for the Scrum Master role, right? Any role demands certain capabilities. If you don't demonstrate that particular capabilities, probably we will not be able to get the sustained respect from the team. Okay. And the last point is also very important. My organization seldom care about my career growth. Yes. So I need to take care of my own career, but every choice has its own consequence. So I just thought to, put it as a last line. Okay. Now what we'll do is, one second. Unfortunately, my mouse has some problem. Okay. Okay. So these are all some of the probable way forward, because till now we have actually discussed on the problem statements and the pain point, because only when you discuss on the problem statement and the pain point, believe me, you will start understanding and appreciating the value of the solution. And only then it will make relevance to understand the solution. So even from a design thinking point of view, don't jump into solution directly. Spend time to understand the problem statement, then jump into the solution. Now, these are all some of the ways which came to my mind. Probably if you people feel something more need to be added, we can actually do so. One is point number one, connect with the like-minded people who take sincere effort to continuously improve themselves. So what I'm trying to say is, how you spend your time is your own thing. But the point is, only when you interact with some people who have the positive mindset and who have the tendency to continuously improve, you will also start imbibing that particular character or that characteristic feature. Okay. If not, you will be carried away by the whims and fantasies of the wind. So I just thought to put that line. Second is, you need to start attending Agile meetups, webinars, read some blogs, and don't do this just to clear interviews. Okay. There is a difference between learning a concept for the sake of joy of learning and learning a concept in a hurry mode. Okay, tomorrow I have an interview, somehow I need to read it. So that hurry mentality will not give a sustained learning. So maybe one need to develop that attitude or the habit of learning things for the joy of learning and not just to clear interviews. So my suggestion could be, the objective is to continuously improve and build the capability. Salary, position, designation, company, all these things will anyway be taken care, provided someone is embarking on the continuous improvement. If someone reads only for interview, after the interview, people will forget it. That's why many people forget after the exam. Once the exam ends, they have forgotten what they read because they have read it only for the sake of an exam. Okay. So that is an important point, what I like to say, why am I saying all these things? Because we are saying Agile is a mindset, right? When we say Agile is a mindset, if you see a lot of places, on the internet, because I myself also did a session with that creator team on Agile is a mindset. When we say that mindset is important, don't we think that our own mindset is also paramount important? So having that mindset to continuously improve is more important rather than doing something for the sake of a job. Okay, so let me complete this slide and then we will give chance to the people who have raised their hands. Okay, then one more thing what I have found, unfortunately so late in life, is success depends on 80% mindset and the 20% is the skills or capabilities. Because if you have the right mindset, you can develop the skills. If you don't have the right mindset, you cannot improve on the skills, because that skills is something which can be learned, okay, which can be learned over a period of time and it can be improved from point X to point Y. So what is more important for sustained success is the positive mindset. So I just start to put 80% mindset and 20% skill. Then what is more important is learn by observing other people, right? So if you have an Agile coach or if you have an Agile program manager or someone who are believed to be leaders in your organization, and if you're participating in in some kind of an interaction with them, observe people and then learn from them. Because that particular learning is much more impactful rather than a theoretically bookish knowledge. Okay. And just to set the context, if you take my own case, right, I also have my own mentors. Like the name of the mentors are also I have put over here. Dan Lok, Dev Gadvi, Fatah Khan. So these are all some of the career transformation coaches, business coaches, or life coach kind of a thing. Of course, these people have not taught me Agile. Agile is something which, no, I have actually picked it up on the way. But all that I'm trying to say is, if someone is really serious about their career, you may need to have some mentor or some coach from where you can accelerate the journey. If you think that, no, you can do it, no, like, no, everything on your own, absolutely, no, you can do it. But it will take 2 years or it will take 2.5 years. Probably if you have a mentor or a coach, instead of 2 years, it may take only 3 to 4 months. So to curtail that particular time gap and to expedite the career journey, probably you can connect with any of your mentors. Okay, now what I'll do, let me stop sharing. Someone want to tell something? I saw some hands raised. Someone raised their hand. Okay, so let me ask a open-ended question. How you felt the probable solutions there? Any perspectives on it? I shared you the slides, right? Probable way forwards. How you felt on those points? You can unmute and then talk. Sindhil, do you want to tell anything, Sindhil? Yeah, you go ahead, Abida. Sorry, I'm not sure I pronounced your name correctly.
Yeah, that's right. Thank you. Yeah. I was just saying that learning was a journey was an important aspect, I think, that I really liked. And not to focus on interview only and to learn, keep on learning. So I'll definitely go pick that up, Balaji, going forward.
Yeah, keep definitely, going. Right. See, I will tell you, no, I can give an example. See, we all understand that saying is very easy, but practicing is very difficult. But at least the saying should be there. Because information should be there, then the transformation comes later. If you don't even have the information, where does the transformation come? Right? So it is something like that. Let me give a simple example. I was actually talking to my dietitian or a fitness coach. Okay. So I told my dietitian, madam, I need to reduce my weight because now the office is all, actually opening up. Many companies are doing a hybrid model. So if I reduce the weight quickly, it will be facilitating me to go to job and come traveling and all. For that, my dietitian told, you see, Balaji, weight reduction is not just for going and coming to work. It is for your holistic improvement, for you to physically be active. And only when you're physically sound, your mind can also be sound. And even for you to perform your work better, your physical fitness is of a paramount importance. Then the thought actually struck me, weight reduction and maintaining fitness is not only for our work. It is for our, your lifetime goal. So along the similar line of thought, learning should be a continuous activity. Of course, if you do continuous activity, it will help you for the interviews. If someone reads only for the interview, probably first level questions may be answered. From your answer, if the interviewer is asking a second level question, it will be difficult to clear the interview. So maybe one need to take up the journey of a continuous learning. Okay, whether you read based on some blogs or you'll watch some YouTube videos or you'll attend webinars or you do some certifications, that is all up to the person. But some amount of reading should be there on a continuous basis. Okay, so what we'll do, we will spend some good amount of half an hour to 40 minutes on some of the difficult questions. So you can start asking the questions now right away. Either me or someone from the group also, we will try to answer it. So can you start posting your questions probably in the chat? like whatever questions you feel as a difficult, okay, don't type simple questions. You can start posting your questions, or you can start bringing your own interview experience and then ask me probably how to do it better. Something like that, we can spend some good amount of minimum of 40 minutes now. Okay. And then we can toggle back to the slide. Or you wanted me to share some scenarios. How is that?
Balaji, Vivek here. I think it would be good if you share some scenario-based questions and answers.
See, Vivek, but the only challenge there is what I perceive as a difficult scenario may not be relevant to the entire audience also, right? Because I work at a leadership level. My challenges are something different. But what I can do is I can tell some pointers for now. Okay. And then possibly once the team gets some thought, you can actually, the people can put the questions. Now, whenever you are, let me put it in a notepad. One second. The same notepad. Okay. See, whenever in an interview, this is something which I have told already also in my YouTube video, you have generally only three kinds of questions. Okay. What are they? First question, simple knowledge level question. Simple question. Let's say, for example, what is the difference between velocity and throughput? If someone is asking this, it is a direct question. If you know the answer, theoretically, you can actually tell them. Velocity is more on the relative points, whereas throughput is more on the absolute number of features delivered, number of user stories delivered, number of sub-epics delivered. So feature, the throughput is more on the absolute countash, right? Now, one more difference is velocity will be used more for predictability, whereas throughput is used for productivity. Because velocity, these many story points I have predicted, these many story points I have delivered. So it is more on the predictability say-do ratio. Whereas throughput is more on number of user stories completed per sprint, number of features completed per program increment. Because productivity will always have a per unit time factor, right? How far a person is productive, how much he has produced by per given a time factor. So that could be the difference between velocity and the throughput. So these questions are direct questions. Second level of a question is, tell me a scenario. Okay, I'm just giving an example, okay? Tell me a scenario or a situation wherein, there was a conflict between your product owner, and the team. Now, you as a Scrum Master, how did you resolve the impediment? All right. This is a direct question, but the point is, it is expecting you to tell a narrative or a storyline. Now, in this, the advantage is, if you have anticipated this question, you can prepare and keep some stories. When I say stories, I'm not trying to falsify or tell fake things. What I meant by story is create a narrative and then keep it ready. That particular flow should be there. These are all the second level of question. Now, believe me, if you prepare well, you can crack these two levels of questions. Even if you don't have hands-on experience, if you prepare well, these two kind of questions can be cracked. Third level is a little bit tricky. For example, I am taking interview, the third round or second round, depending upon the client, I used to ask most of the questions of the third type only. The interviewer is actually showing a cumulative flow diagram or a burn down chart, a real-time cumulative flow diagram or a burn down chart, and then asking you, by looking at the chart or by looking at the CFD, can you tell what would be the bottlenecks? And can you tell what could be the pointers to solve the problem? Something like that. So this is the most difficult question. These two questions, you can handle it. See, even this question, if it has been known to you, You can talk to a person who had done it hands-on. You can watch some YouTube videos, particularly on how to interpret a burn-down chart. And then you can tell. But the probability of clearing the interview will be less if most of the questions are of a third category question. So my suggestion is, whenever someone asks you a question, first thing what you need to do is take a pause. Okay? Resist the temptation to jump in to answer immediately. Because I have seen people, they will be waiting when to open their mouth to answer. No. There should be a minimum 4 to 5 seconds of a pause. You need to structure your thoughts. You need to organize your thoughts. Only when there is a clarity in the thoughts, people will have clarity in the words, right? So have clarity in the thoughts, have structurize your thoughts, and then go to the answer. Like this, you may need to prepare. Now, let me stop sharing. I just want to hear from you how you felt that. Are any comments? Okay, Vivek, did I made myself clear, Vivek, in terms of explaining the three types of questions?
Yes, Balaji. Yeah, thanks. It's very helpful for me.
Yeah. So what we need to do is, going forward, if someone is asking an interview question, immediately your mind should think, okay, this question fits into which particular bucket. If you know the degree of complexity of a question, accordingly, you can try to prepare your answer in the mind and then address the question. Okay. See, the point is like this. Of course, I can tell answers to the questions, whatever you guys are asking me. But instead of giving you people a fish, I wanted to teach fishing to you. So that when there is a situation, you can do fishing and then catch the fish. Because as a mentor, one of the responsibility of a coach or a mentor is to give the capability so that people find the answers. Okay, now the question changes, means then how will you get an answer for that question? So develop the capability to go to your level. Any question comes, you can handle it. That is the permanent solution, and there is no shortcut to success. Okay, let me put it very clear. There is no shortcut to success. All the tricks and trades will not give any sustained outcomes in the long run. Maybe once in a while, it will give some success. Only when you tread the path of continuous learning and learning from everything, you can create a sustained success. Okay, now, okay, so this is something which you need to do. Fine. Now, do you want to ask me any, okay, so maybe if you guys wanted to ask me any real-time questions, we can actually discuss now, one or two questions at least. So that we will see, the coverage of the answer. Like, I'm sure that you guys are going for an interview once in a while at least, so you can start asking me those questions. Maybe you felt as difficult, or maybe you felt as probably you can do it in a better manner. Okay, like that, if you ask me any questions, I can answer you, because only from that answer I can give you the tips and tricks and all. Okay, yeah, go ahead, Abhiti. I am sorry, I could not pronounce your name. Yeah, okay, yeah, go ahead.
The question what I would been asked is like, why there should be a role as only Scrum Master? Why the Scrum Master role should not be clubbed with a developer or tester? So what they were asking, what was my thought process, and why it is good to have only one role for a dedicated person?
Okay, so let us actually do like this. Before I jump into giving my own perspectives, I just wanted to know what is the answer you had told, and anyone from the group also wanted to answer this question, you can go ahead and then answer. And then finally, I will share my perspective. So what is the answer that you had given when they asked?
I told Scrum Master is a change agent, and he needs to take care of his, as per the rules and responsibility, he needs to take care of team, organization, and few responsibility towards the product owner. Mm-hmm. If he has some other responsibilities, if he's a tester or a developer, he may not be playing the complete role or influence people in some other different way.
Mm.
like if he's part of the team, he might not be, he might be influenced by the team. He might not think from his perspective. So it would be a good to have a individual role rather than mixing up with two roles. Kind of a something on this line.
That is your perspective to that question. Anyone wanted to make an attempt here to answer to this question now from the group? Rajeshwari, do you want to make a try, Rajeshwari, to answer this question? I'm not sure whether she is not able to come out of mute or something. Okay, so let me share my perspective now, whatever comes to my mind. See, the point is, every role in a framework, yes, has a purpose behind it. Now, why did they introduce this particular Scrum Master role? As you had rightly mentioned, one point is that there should not be any biasing in terms of process orientation. So we need a person who is part of the larger team, but then not a part of the development team, like, you know, the team as such. Now, some more perspectives are the incisors. If this Scrum Master role is not there, what will happen? No, if there is any impediment to solve, much of the time, the energy, the effort of the team will be going in solving the impediment rather than focusing on the core work. So Scrum Master is more of a process facilitator, more of a systems coach, means as system thinking coach, more of an impediment removing person, more of an improvement enabler. If you take Lisa Atkinson, now the coaching book, she used to use these powerful words: impediment remover, collaboration conductor, improvement enabler, all these words. Now the point is, if there is a Scrum Master, the Scrum Master could be the single point of contact in terms of resolving impediments, in terms of tracking the aging of the impediments, and then facilitate the collaboration so that the team can focus much of the time on the core work, rather than talking to the dependency team. Because when I was working as a Scrum Master, right? Like, no, first of all, no? Like, I used to go to the dependent teams and then set the context and then get their time and then once again come back here to this team, and then try to serve as a bridge. So only when inevitably needed, people will come to the meetings. Okay, so one of the responsibility of a Scrum Master is to protect the team as a shield from the external disturbances, right? When I say external disturbances, it could be from the dependent teams, sometimes from the vendors, sometimes from the suppliers also. So probably those particular answers can also be clubbed to your answer. Like whatever you told, I'm not saying it is not a correct answer. Probably you can club these many perspectives also. So in an interview, my say is try to give as many perspectives as possible. Why? Because we don't know what is exactly there in the mind of the interviewer, right? If you just tell only one or two perspectives, if that perspective is not there in the mind of the interviewer, probably it could be a case for rejection, right? So try to generate perspectives. And all reading, the purpose of all webinars, agile meetups, the purpose of any learning is to expand our horizons of thinking. Only when we expand our horizons of thinking, instead of generating two perspectives, if you are able to generate seven or eight perspectives, probably the solutions will be, the viability, the feasibility of obtaining solutions will be more. Okay. I hope I answered your question.
Yeah. Thank you, Balaji. Thank you.
Yeah, sure. So see, the one more way to learn, no, whenever you find any positive adjectives, no, like you actually pen it down and then try to, you know, correlate or corroborate it with, okay, does this positive adjective makes relevance for the characteristic feature of an agile coach? Something, when I say positive adjective, what I meant is something like this: a collaboration conductor, improvement enabler, something like that. Okay. That is just a side note information. Okay, now let's see some questions here. Arjun had actually typed some question. How to convert agile outcome to business outcome with respect to hard saving under soft saving? Okay, Arjun, I'm not sure you have some challenge to unmute yourself to talk. I already allowed you to talk. I'm not sure whether you're right. So can you ping us here? What do you mean by hard and soft saving? If you can tell me in some English, what do you mean by hard and soft saving? Yeah, I'm actually posting it to everyone. Okay, he has posted it only to me. Okay, now what I do, I'm just copying the Arjun's question and then I'm posting it to all now. So I just wanted to know from the person who had posted in, like, in dollar value, is a hard saving. Okay, is it an industry term or I'm not sure whether it is a, okay, something like that you are saying. Hard, soft saving is not directly in the dollar. Okay. Agile outcome to business outcome with respect to hard saving. Okay. I think I have answered this question once in one of the webinar, but 1 second, wait. I'll just take the slide. Because this particular answer is in some other webinar, I have done a slide. I'm just seeing whether the slide is there here. Okay, luckily the slide is there. Okay, so let me share the screen. Only thing is instead of looking into that slide, we are now going looking into some other PPT now. Okay, take a look into this particular slide. See here. Okay, sorry. Here, what are we? 1 minute. Okay, here, what are we trying to say? Why agile transformation is important? We are starting with some agile practices, and these practices are going to enable some agile capabilities, which is going to drive an agile outcome through which I can accomplish a business outcome. One of the example is probably the next slide. One minute. See here. I am starting with doing some extreme programming practices, right? Which we call as an engineering practices or the technical agility. So I put it in the shift left. By implementing the shift left, I am enabling or contributing better to build a robust CI/CD pipeline. Okay, now because of that, what happened? Because I have a mechanism of a on-click production deployment, I am able to compress my lead time and the cycle time. Because of which, what will happen? The time to market will get improved. And because of that, the CSAT score will going to improve. CSAT score is the business outcome. Whereas your compressed cycle time, lead time, your predictability, your productivity, responsiveness, quality, flow efficiency, these things comes under something called the agile outcome. But I cannot touch my business outcome and the agile outcome if I don't have my capabilities, okay, which we saw in the previous slide. But to get that capability, I need to do some practices. So I think this slide, with this example, at least you can understand the flow or the connecting thread. Let me look into the chat for your answer. Are you able to get what I'm trying to tell, Arjun? Can you put one more yes? Because this, I have a doubt. This yes stands for the previous yes or for my answer. Okay, fine. So this is how, see, actually whatever question Arjun asked, you know, that is a very impactful question, because that particular question says, don't do agile for the sake of agile. Every agile transformation has a business driver behind it. Understand why am I doing or what am I doing? So when you connect it back to the business outcome, I think that makes more relevance. Okay, that is what he was trying to ask. Now, hard saving, no, like based on the terminology, nomenclature, whatever being told here, hard saving, yes, probably it could be in that dollar value, because I am able to compress the time to market and come up with a better GTM strategy, go to market strategy. Now I am able to conquer multiple market channels, not only in a APAC region, but also in the EMEA region. This could be in terms of the revenue margin. But revenue will always have some other positive impacts also. For example, improvement in the product brand index, improvement in the employee engagement score, improvement in the CSAT number, and the improvement in the partner health index, which we can do it through some surveys. Those are all could be the soft savings. Okay, so here they call it as a hard saving, soft saving. Maybe like you can actually, because but everything, you see, the point is like this. It is like something like this. One good habit is going to lead to some other good habit. One bad habit will lead to some other bad habit, right? So if I don't take measures to reduce the time to market, probably the CSAT score will also go low, because the market has been captured by some other competitor, because of which the credibility goes down. Once the credibility goes down, the product brand index goes down, then the employee engagement goes down, the team morale goes down. So it is like, because we are living in a system thinking world, right? Everything is interrelated. Nothing operates in a silo mode. See, okay, why there is a change in the price value of some commodities whenever there is a war between Russia and whatever be the country, you know, the Ukraine or whatever be the country? Because the world is a cluster, right? All are connected hubs. Something happens in one part of the world is going to trigger. So from my perspective, I don't see hard saving as soft saving as distinctive two compartments. From a system thinking point of view, they are interlinked. Of course, from a reporting point of view, yes, you can call out hard saving and the soft saving. Okay. What is cold team room in Agile? No, yeah, I'm also known. I'm just hearing this term for the first time, because I'm just wondering whether these terms are global teams or something internal to your organization. What is the context, Vivek? Can you just tell the context? Context behind this.
Yes, Balaji. I was exploring on that impediment removal and all. Mm-hmm. So that time, I think when I was going through some blogs, I found this. So I never heard this before. So I had this doubt. I was not clear what is this whole team room means actually. So even I asked few of my friends who are working as a Scrum Master. Even I didn't. So I thought, okay, let me ask here.
Okay. Maybe after the break we can see. I can try to see whether I have it in somewhere in any of my archived material. But I'm not sure. Are they talking about any kind of a collaborative space or a virtual space or what is that? No, I'm not sure. Okay.
Okay, Balaji.
Okay, sure. So anyway, the question has been noted. We can actually find out the answer. That's not a challenge. Okay. Because we cannot expect that everyone knows everything. No. Because some terms may not be used by us. Right. All right. Okay. So let me tell some sample questions. No. For example, some of the questions, if you are taking the role of a Scrum Master or if you're taking the role of an Agile coach, some of the commonly expected questions are, how do you track dependencies? Or rather, how do you handle dependencies across multiple teams? That can be some of the question. So what thoughts come to your mind generally? How will you handle dependency? Because I just want to share you some important questions and then give you some tips, some way of answering those questions. So that intent, but then remember, please remember, the intent is not to just know answer to that question. The intent is to get the thinking pattern behind that question so that you can reuse that particular thinking pattern to some other questions also. Okay. So what thoughts you guys have, no, in terms of dependency management? Okay. Arjun says, create a program board with risk and dependency. Yes. One, the moment you create a program board and then you call out the dependency. Now, one point we need to keep in mind. Dependencies can come in four ways, no? Even in a traditional waterfall model, start to start, start to finish, finish to start, finish to finish. So we need to be very clear which particular aspect the dependency is and whether it is an inter-team dependency or an intra-team dependency. or sometimes the dependencies could be from our vendors or suppliers. So if you know that extent of the dependency, then probably you can take a thinking pattern whether I can handle this particular dependency in my program increment planning meeting or in my product owner sync up meeting. Does this dependency need to be discussed, or in my SOS, which we call as a scrum of scrum meeting, do we need to discuss? So you may need to go in that angle, probably in terms of the dependency management. And one thing what I say in a risk, no, as far as an agile driven engagement is considered, risk has been thought right from the beginning, because at any point of time, you are anyway working on the highest priority work item. It is not in traditional model, I have a plan and I need to follow a plan. Here, responding to change over following a plan, right? So risk will be to some extent internally taken care by now my suggestion is, when you people are reading your burn down chart, you can create your risk burn down chart also. There is a way to create a risk burn down chart. You can try to watch some videos, you try to do a Google search, post it in some forums, someone will actually let you know. There is a way to draw a risk burn down chart, and during the sprint, like during the daily stand up call, we can ask some powerful questions to the team. See, stand up call says what you have done yesterday, or rather what is the plan for today? Do you have any impediments or blockers? That actually does not necessarily mean only these three things need to be discussed. That is a guidelines given by the Scrum guide or whatever it is. That doesn't mean we will discuss only these three things. Anything which is of relevance need to be called out, right? So in a daily stand-up meeting, you can also project the risk burn down chart. And then as a team, you can collaborate and then see how many risks we have completed as the days progress. Because why? Because accumulating the risk itself till the last day of the sprint is the biggest risk, right? If you keep on accumulating the risk, then it's a biggest risk. Yes, at a program level, you can create a ROM board, which is going to tell four types of risk: resolved, owned, accepted, and mitigated. Okay, what are all the risks which has been resolved as and when we discuss in the PI planning? What are all the risks which has been owned by the teams? What are all the risks which has been accepted? Yes, anyway, the risk is bound to happen. What are all the risks? We have created a mitigation plan, something like that, which Arjun is trying to ping here as a ROM, okay, which you can do. So these are all concepts, but you need to know the context behind the concept, right? Genuinely, you can handle the risk. And how will you quantify your risk? Like in terms of the dollar value? If someone is asking you, is there any formula to measure the risk? What is the formula to measure the risk generally?
Probability to occurrence.
Yeah, probability, occurrence, both mean the same thing. So it is the impact into probability. Impact. Okay, let me type here. EMV of a risk, expected monetary value of a risk, is measured by the impact. Impact means the degree of damage into probability, the occurrence of it, the periodicity of it, the likelihood of it. Likelihood is a better word than periodicity or frequency. Likelihood of the risk. Say for one, for example, I can just a layman example. In this particular point on the planet Earth, if an earthquake comes, then all these buildings are going to collapse, let's say in a particular region. But what is the probability? Probability seems to be very less. So the total EM, the total damage will be less. So it is like we need to multiply the both, okay? But I don't suggest people to do any kind of an extensive risk assessment or formulas as far as an agile driven engagement is been considered. Why? Because agile as a philosophy or a mindset itself factors the risk right from the beginning. No, when you are prioritizing the highest value work itself, you are always focusing on the highest value work. The only thing what we are missing, the missing pieces to the puzzle, is people start thinking risk as a separate activity. No, You need to bring it inside your daily stand-up meeting itself. Does that make relevance to you people? I'm sharing my own perspectives, okay? It's not that you need to agree to whatever I'm saying. You can still give your counter views provided you are able to justify it. Okay, because that's how we learn, right? Only when you tell something new, I will also learn and you will also learn, and then we can exchange our thoughts. All right, so we need to keep some watchful eye on the dependence. See, now you guys tell me, no? How many of you really measure impediment aging? Like you, most of you are working as a Scrum Master. Do you maintain an impediment tracker wherein you capture your impediments and start measuring the aging of the impediments? Many people will put the impediment and then they will tag it to a subtask type, because in Jira, you have an impediment type itself, because Jira treats everything as an issue type, right? So you can create an impediment of type impediment, and then you can tag it under a subtask. But the point what I'm trying to say is, using a tool in itself is not going to bring agility, right? So you need to measure the aging of the impediments and then start taking steps to compress the impediment time, the aging. So how will you do it? Like, what steps can be taken to compress the, okay, let me actually put this question here. What steps you will take, you will take, let's say, to compress the aging of the impediment. So can you people start typing, or you can unmute and then share your thoughts? You understood the question, right? The question is very simple. We are all talking about impediments. Only thing now I told is, why don't we maintain a tracker to capture the aging of the impediments? Aging means what? Like, we have defect aging. We actually log the defect, no? And we say, right, this particular defect is kept open for 5 days. This defect is kept open for 7 days. Similarly, you can maintain a tracker to capture the impediments and start measuring the aging of the impediments, okay? Now, my question is, what are all the checks and balances of what you can do proactively to reduce the aging of the impediments? Let's see. Does anyone wanted to answer? Yeah, someone raised a, yeah, go ahead, please. Yeah.
First, maybe we'll go ahead with the, as we have identified all the impediments, first we'll go ahead with the priority one issues, blockers. Okay. And which are blocking us on day-to-day basis. And then the second would be which are not helping us to deliver value at the end of the sprint goal. Second priority of it. At the end of the sprint, if that, like for example, if team is not clear with any of the user story and product owner is not around, we need to find some solution to identify the impediment. It is a major impediment for the team. So we might not be able to deliver the story. Either we have to deprioritize it or take somebody's help who can help us to make them understand if they're missing anything. For starters, I would start with these two priority and then schedule a call for daily until we meet this. And based on the aging ones, which are not so priority, we can try and add it in our backlog to see how we can pick it up in future sprints.
Okay. See, now, okay. Oh, yeah, we are fine. So let me share my viewpoints and then we'll see how to converge it further. See, first of all, in an interview, if someone is asking you, let's say, how will you do this particular work? It could be aging of impediments, or if it is something else, you need to question back the interviewer saying, what is your role in that? Okay, why am I saying this particularly means, for the same problem statement, if you are a Scrum Master, you may need to think differently. If you are an Agile project manager, program manager, then you may need to wear a different hat. However, the problem is same, right? Problem is same. Situation is same. Scenario is same. That doesn't mean I give the same answer or respond to the same situation unless and until I get my clarity, who am I in that role? If I'm an agile project manager, then accordingly I will contextualize the answer. If I'm a scrum master or an agile coach, the way I answer it will be a little bit different. However, the question is same, right? So one way to begin the answer is you may need to, because in sometimes the interviewer will clearly say, if you are a scrum master, then how will you handle this particular situation? So the question is very complete. If the question is not complete, okay, how will you handle this? Of course, if it is a role of a scrum master interview, it is understood that they are asking you for a scrum master role only. But still, it is better to check the understanding, point number one. Point number two is, if there is an impediment, right, you need to understand the workflow of the impediment also, right? Because never any material talks about workflow of an impediment. People will only talk about workflow of a defect or a process workflow. Impediment also has a workflow. Somewhere it is getting created, somewhere it is getting blocked by some team one, then by team two, then only it is getting a result. So unless and until I know the curve or the trace out of the impediment, how I can handle it. And then I need to see what are all the dependent teams, what are all the, okay, is it due to test data, it is being kept as a blocker, or is it due to anything like a test environment, or it is waiting for any shared service call, or it's waiting for an API call, why the dependency came in the first picture, and then start collaborating with that particular team. And you also need to look into it, how this can be proactively addressed going forward in your retrospective. Now, as you got rightly mentioned, sometimes what would have happened, you know, the product owner had not created visibility on the backlog. And by the time it came to the team, that story itself came to the team just one day before the beginning of the first iteration, or rather the iteration. Now the team is in the last day of the current iteration. Let's say on Monday, we are going to begin the first iteration, the new iteration. Now, if the story comes very late, people are doing planning to the story when they are supposed to do execution. So this is a systemic issue. You need to solve it holistically, not just by local optimization. Or how do you feel? I will take a pause here and there just to know your perspectives. Then the question will come. Okay, see, now the problem got shifted to some other layer. Then the question will come, okay, the story came late. It is fully agreed. Because the story came late, I was not able to deliver within the sprint. Now, why the story came late? Because there is no program level cadence. There is no portfolio level cadence, which is happening on a continuous manner in terms of epic and sub-epic cleanup, in terms of your demand backlog refinement. I'm talking about demand backlog. I'm not talking about product backlog. There is always a demand backlog or an opportunity backlog, which is a virtual backlog, which is not visible, but somewhere the demand got it triggered. Now, if we started thinking about dependencies at that layer itself, then it is not going to kill us agility inside the iteration. So why the story came late? Because the story was not refined by the product owner well ahead. Now, why it came late? Probably there is no feature backlog or refinement. Feature backlog refinement is one level above, right? You refine the feature continuously. If you take my teams, right? My teams refine epic and sub-epic every 2 weeks once. Every 14 days, they used to do epic level definition of a ready. So the epics are ready, the sub-epics are ready. Why am I using the term sub-epic? Because we use a rally. And in rally, we have a term called a sub-epic. Because the epics and the sub-epics have been cleaned up on a periodic basis, it is giving the benefit to the features, right? And because the features are getting cleaned, when I say clean up, I'm talking about definition of ready, predominantly at a epic level, definition of ready at a feature level. Now, if you don't do portfolio level cadences and program level cadences, believe me, it will not give any benefit to the team level cadences. Let me take a pause here to know your perspectives. Any other thoughts to share?
Sir, yes, I believe this sort of issue to address, we require a high degree of collaboration between the teams if it is at the enterprise level. As you said, mentioned that most of refinement at the top level is required at the enterprise level.
Correct. So what we'll do, one second, wait. You people are able to see the screen, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so let me, I'm just trying to take a whiteboard. See, these things under, I already written my LinkedIn articles. From there, you can pick it up. See, now we have our team level cadences, like your product backlog refinement, your sprint planning, your daily stand-up meeting, your sprint review, and then followed by your sprint demo retrospective, right? Now, what we are saying, I'll put one more program level cadence, feature backlog refinement, product owner sync up meeting, product manager sync up meeting, ART sync up meeting, SOS, something like that. But why to stop only there? I'll put one more portfolio level cadence, epic and sub-epic cleanup, investment mapping to the strategic teams. So my teams are doing portfolio level cadences once in 14 days and feature backlog refinement once in a week. So that is what I'm saying. There is a difference between reading for the sake of an interview and reading for sake of the joy of learning. My teams are not refining it for this, for the program increment. Yes, it is going to benefit the program increment, which I never deny, but refinement is a continuous process. I am not refining my epic and sub-epic because I need to bring it inside the sprint. No. I need to create visibility at all layers. So I am refining. And as you had rightly mentioned, this requires a different degree of coaching. Something like an enterprise agile coach should talk to your product owner or the head of the product management group, and then they need to create visibility at a product roadmap level. Only then epic will come. If not, how come epic will suddenly commence it? Does that make relevance to you people?
Yes.
See, now the point is, theoretically, no, if you're going by the certifications, if you're going by the certification, yes, Scrum Master is an impediment remover. Agreed. But to what extent? Do you think a Scrum Master can really go and coach the head of the product? Because Scrum Master is a team level coach. That is where the responsibility of an enterprise agile coach or something like a program level coach, because in some of our engagements, we used to call them as a integration coach. Integration coach will be positioned at a product line level, which is at a LOB, or at a product group level, which is a combination of multiple LOBs. Now, these coaches will go and talk to the head of the product management group saying that, you see, for the program increment planning, we have some challenges on visibility of the backlog. So can you talk to your business sponsor to create visibility on the horizon continuously? So creating visibility on the horizon is independent of the framework being used. In fact, it is independent of the methodology of the software itself. Even in a waterfall model, you need to be clear on what are the requirements, right? It has nothing to do with Agile. Agile says, don't maintain bulky document recommendation. You take a lean approach to collecting requirements in the form of a user story. That actually doesn't mean because I'm executing Agile, I will create visibility only at the last moment. Absolutely no. Okay. So I just wanted to know from you people, like what is the challenge now? Now you know the answer, no? But because you know the answer, you cannot just like that go and get things done in an organization, right? There should be a process set in place. You need to talk to someone. You need to make them understand. So it is going to take a good amount of time to make the changes. But at least you need to travel in the right direction. That's what I am trying to tell. Whether you travel at 40 kilometer per hour or 80 kilometer per hour, that is up to you. But are you traveling in the right direction? Because what's the point in driving a car in the wrong direction fast? So think through all these lines. Because I also had all these challenges. So don't ever feel demotivated that you are not able to solve a challenge or something like that. Okay. If all problems are easily solvable, we will not have our jobs. So some problems will be there. But the point is, Only when you pick up these capabilities, no, answering in the interview will be taken care of automatically. If not, you may need to read extensively for the sake of interview. You agreed, right? What I'm trying to tell. If you really do all these things hands-on, then if you prepare a little bit, it is enough. If not, you need to read a lot, because you need to showcase in interview as if you are actually a different person, right? Because everyone has the tendency to, you know, slightly exaggerate our capabilities in the interview, which is nothing wrong. Because even companies exaggerate their capabilities and then only win the projects. They used to tell, I have 150 scaled program consultants, so you can win the project. Once the deal gets signed, then they will take the fund from the deal and then sponsor, and then they will get it done. But so these things happen, okay? So just to think through all those things, but at least this webinar should open up your perspective of thinking and give you some more confidence on your capabilities. Okay. All right. See, we will just take a five minutes break, and then we will rejoin. Means the webinar will be on mode only. I will just go and then come back just for 5 minutes. In the meantime, I will share some of my links. The people who are joining for the first time can probably try to become part of my Facebook group, which I created for Agile, and my YouTube channel, my Twitter, because now I started using Twitter also to a considerable extent to make short videos and all on the Agile, the topic. Okay, I'm just pinging it in the chat. If in case you have not subscribed, you can take pointers from here and then you can send me a connection request. Okay, let me take a 5 minutes break and then I will circle back here. All right, thanks. I'll just pause the recording 1 minute. All right. So what is that we can do now is we will just complete the remaining two slides, because I just want to show you some kind of a do's and don'ts, which I felt as very, very important or significant. Okay. Let me continue with this slide. See, here I have given some kind of a do's and don'ts, like in terms of when you are preparing for the interview, left side is more on the do. Of course, I had only very little point to put on the do, because what's more important is the don'ts. Okay. So maybe you can read it and then get to know. So whenever it comes in terms of preparation for the interview, JD is of a paramount importance, right? So you need to get the job description, maintaining a positive mindset, deep dive into the concepts, not just a shallow reading. And if possible, you try to have a mock interview to get with some expert to get a feedback. Do these things, you can put it in the do's. If you take the don'ts, I have made one of the video also. From there also, you can take some pointers. Predominantly, it is like taken for granted mentality, or rather, attitude. That is something which is a very dangerous one. And the second thing is overconfidence, shallow reading. Like for example, I have seen a candidate. He actually claimed to be Safe Agile scaled program consultant and all. And you believe me, I was asking him, he was actually keep on using the word strategic team, okay, which comes in the portfolio level. And then I asked him, okay, what do you mean by strategic team? And he is telling, strategic team is going to connect your portfolio vision to the enterprise. Yes, fine. Can you give me an example? He is not able to give an example for a strategic team. I'm getting puzzled. When people are not confident on the word, then why are they using that word? For example, if you take my own real-time project, Factory of it Tomorrow, cloud-enabled services, microservices based deployment models. These are the strategic themes. Means what? The organization or at a portfolio level, we have taken a decision to fund the investment pertaining to cloud-enabled services, or Factory of Tomorrow, which is more of a research R&D, or something on microservices based deployment. So using the jargons without understanding the meaning, it's a potentially, it could result in the pitfall. Okay. Then some people will have that mentality that, why do you need to take a mock interview, because I will not go wrong anywhere, so the feedback is not needed. And some people, they are not able to talk about evidences of a success. Means if someone is asking you, okay, you have used a CI/CD pipeline, so what? Can you tell me some success metrics? You should be able to quantify the number. Before using CI/CD, the cycle time was this, or the lead time was this, or something was this number. After using CI/CD pipeline, the same attribute, the same variable name had a betterment on the value. So people are not able to talk about evidences of a success. The other area where generally people go for a failure is, they will focus only on an agile transformation, because you need to read the overlapping areas also. When you're preparing for the agile transformation, you need to know a little bit on that digital transformation, business transformation, cultural transformation. And as one of the habit is not taking a pause, no, after the question has been asked, immediately jumping into the answering mode, even without understanding the context of the question. Okay, one second. Okay, not able to talk challenges at an appropriate level. See, I have given a simple example. If you are applying for a position of an enterprise agile coach, if someone is asking you the interviewer is asking you in the interview, okay, can you tell me some couple of challenges? You need to tell challenges at that level. You should not telling challenges about the Jira integration, or I did not have a Jenkins pipeline got broken, or my Bitbucket did not work when I pushed the code, or my pom.xml was not able to understand the environment settings from the Ansible. Like that, you should not tell. Because those challenges will make relevance for a DevOps consultant, not for an enterprise agile coach. An enterprise agile coach should talk about business optimization challenges, or something like cultural transformation related challenges, or creating a change management model related challenges. So look at the level and then make the challenge appropriately. Then domain specific challenges. See, for example, if the interviewer is asking you, can you tell me about an agile transformation challenge for a BFSI domain, you should not tell general agile transformation. You need to read case studies, particularly for BFSI, particularly for healthcare domain, and then go prepared over that. And if they're asking you, okay, let's say in a large scale agile transformation, we had an ERP implementation, like what could be the potential challenges? Your challenges, your answers should echo that particular ERP context. You should echo the domain context or the technical context. If you talk about generic challenges, it will not work out, right? I see a lot of candidates are failing in this area. Now, then also people have the mindset, visualizing Agile as the only silver bullet to solve all the problems under the sun means, I have implemented Scrum, I implemented Kanban, I implemented Safe, expecting Scrum, Kanban, Safe to take care of everything. Absolutely no. See, it is like this. You have a car driver, you have a maid in the house, and you have a caretaker or someone, but you still try to oversee, no, whether the maid is working properly or the driver is working properly. Expecting that frameworks will run by itself is not going to solve the problem. And frameworks will not address systemic issues. Systemic issues are issues which are inherently present in the landscape. Frameworks will actually bring the problem to the surface. It is not going to solve the problem. People need to come together to solve the problem. So whenever I'm going for a presentation, no, to a new client, when the client is saying me, we need to implement safe Balaji, something like that they used to tell me. So the first question what I ask them is, what do you want out of Safe? What are all your current pain points? Then they ask me, only very few people like you ask me this question itself. Whenever I tell to some other vendors of us, they immediately jump into essential Safe. They will tell, let us put an arc, let us put a solution train. We will do it, but do with an understanding. No. So if you don't even know why am I implementing safe for the client, then how will you obtain business outcomes, right? So expecting Agile to solve all the problems is a big no. Agile is a powerful vehicle, fully agreed. It will try to bring the problems to the surface, but people need to collaborate and then fix it. Okay. So I generally use to this common example. Like I'm not sure how far it is relevant. Generally, when we try to shave or when we try to dress up, we actually use a mirror, because mirror enables me to see. But mirror is not going to solve the problem, right? You still need to use the mirror to ensure that you are dressing up well or something like that. So frameworks are mirrors which is going to bring the problem to you on the surface, but framework is not going to solve the problem. Okay, then this point is very important. Not able to talk about value adds. If someone is asking you, okay, you have implemented Kanban, you are saying, okay, apart from the project initiatives, do you have any kind of a value adds? It could be at an account level or it could be at an organization level. Many people are not able to answer it. Then sometimes not questioning back the question to get a converging point and start answering from a divergent zone. Say for example, if the interviewer is asking you, okay, how will you create a coaching plan? For whom? Is it for team or for product owner or for RTE or for scrum masters? Even within teams, is it for my scrum Kanban teams? Are you talking about program teams or portfolio teams? So don't try to answer from a diverging zone. You try to ask the follow-up question, bring the diverging zone to a converging point, then actually hit it on the nail, the head on the nail, something like that. So this is also one of the area. And people do not look out for principles behind the practices. Okay, that is what we generally used to tell. No, there is a difference between doing Agile and being Agile. But then believe me, you cannot be Agile without beginning the journey to do Agile. You need to do Agile first. Then comes the stage of a be Agile. Suddenly we cannot become a be Agile overnight. Okay, so these are all some of the things. Definitely it is not a copy paste from the Google. These are all my own thoughts as an interview panel for almost 6 to 6.5 years. I have tried to put it. Do you guys wanted to add anything more to it, or you want to share anything? See, now the point is like this. No, now we have some 12 people in this 12, including me. If you remove me, 11 people. Don't you guys think you also have these challenges? How many of you really tell me, if they're asking you, okay, what are all the safe implementation challenges at a healthcare, for a healthcare client? How many of you can really speak confidently? You can speak challenges on safe, or you can speak challenges on healthcare, but not combined, correct? Maybe you, if you are prepared, you can speak. If there is no preparation, it will be very, very difficult to speak. Because when things need to be inside to project outside, no? When inside there is no things, then how it can be projected? So think through along those lines. Is there any chat? Okay, Rajeshwari has a question. As a scrum master, do you think by increasing the velocity, productivity of the team can be increased? Well, see, it is a question which has yes or no. The point is like this. By increasing the velocity, actually what we mean is that completing the story points, completing the user stories within the same iteration, ensuring that the user stories are not getting carried forwarded to the next sprint or iteration. If that is the tendency, if that is the mindset behind the word velocity, then yes, improving the velocity has an improvement in the throughput also. Because for a commonsensical reason, only when I meet the definition of done for that user story, I can claim the points, right? Story points can be claimed only when you meet the definition of done. From that perspective, yes, increasing the velocity definitely increases the productivity. However, if people have the mentality to increase the points alone when you're doing the planning of the sprint, then increasing the velocity will not improve the productivity. So these are all some kind of a tricky questions, which doesn't have one answer. It all depends upon the way in which you actually interpret the word of velocity over there. Are you okay, Rajeshwari?
Sir, I missed the second part. Actually, what do you mean by increasing the number?
Okay. What I meant by increasing the number is, actually the story is only five points here, but the team is putting 13 points. See, the story, actual going by the factuality of the data, the story is of 5 points, but the team is putting it more than 5 points. So if you claim it by completing that 8-point user story, you are actually claiming the points. Velocity increases, but from in the long term perspective, productivity does not increase. Am I not able to put my thoughts to you? I'm just wondering, or is it something from your end or from my end that I'm not? Did any of you understood? No, what I'm trying to tell.
Yes, sir. I've got your point, sir, here, but relative point estimation is not working out, as they are trying to put a 5-pointer as a 13-pointer just to increase the velocity of the sprint.
That's what I'm actually trying to tell. Just to increase the velocity, just to increase the story points for the namesake, to project as if we are doing more, if they put higher points, it is not going to, in fact, it is a detrimental approach. So those subtle elements also need to be taken care of. Now, that is where the Scrum Master... the Scrum Master should actually enable the collaboration between product owner and the team and the functional SMEs. Now the point is, the challenge is like this. Sometimes the Scrum Master is not a technical guy. Scrum Master is not a functional SME. Scrum Master doesn't know the application context. So Scrum Master cannot tell anything on that. But all that he can do is to facilitate the collaboration between diversified parties like product owner, technical lead, and functional SME. Hey guys, is this really 8 points? Going by one story point reference. That's why we are telling, create a wall of reference. One story point for my team means what kind of a user story. You need to create a sample story. If this story is one story point, is this story is really 8 or 13 points or where it is? Such a discussion should happen. Rajeshwari, did I make myself understandable now? If still problem, you connect with me. If still you have challenge, you connect with me offline.
Okay. Yes, sir, it's clear now.
Yeah, so do you think by increasing the velocity, productivity of the team can be increased? Absolutely, yes. Provided the connotation of velocity under productivity is properly followed. If there are some ifs and buts in the meaning and the interpretation, then increasing the velocity need not increase the productivity. It will give only falsified picture. Something like that, okay. Can I tell an example? It's like a layman example. I'm not sure how far it is very correct, but still I will tell something closest example. It is like a person who is saying, last time when I weighed, it was like 90 kg for me. Now the same person last time when he was weighing with his shoes. Now that person removed the shoes and then saying, I have lost 2.5 kg. Absolutely no, right? Because you cannot compare both, right? So the scale of reference should not be changed. So my say is that during the sprint planning meeting, we need to be a little bit careful whether it's really a 5-story point, because the concept says card, conversation, confirmation. Before confirmation, using the card, conversation is very important, right? Individuals and interactions over processes and tools. So the conversation should take care of all these nitty-gritties or subtle nuances. Okay, fine. But anyway, that's a good question, which I liked it, both from an interview point of view and the implementation point of view. All right, okay, fine. So if we are done, I'll just quickly go to some of my some of the things which I do. This is my particular website. One second here. Here also you can go and try to learn a lot of things. Okay, this is my website wherein which I like. As you know, I have my Agile mentorship program across different levels. This is a customized Agile framework. which we call as a CIF. Here you see, here I have something called the investment mix, and here I have strategy. Whichever is going to support my investment mix, only those particular initiatives will be funded, and only funded initiatives is going to become part of the road mapping journey, right? So in this website, you can go through these particular lesson plans. And for example, I'm just giving an example. If you want to know what is the lesson plan to become an enterprise agile coach, probably you can go through these particular topics. Okay, probably I can walk you through even from the LinkedIn. Okay, one minute. There is some problem. It's not a problem. I just went to the wrong page because of this slider heading. So in the LinkedIn also, I have written articles pertaining to level one, level two, 150 interview questions and answer, JD based coaching, lot of things. So you can go through these particular topics. Okay, this is for a level two, and this is for a level one. So all these things are integrated anyway in the portal. And if you go to my YouTube channel, I also have 1 hour video for all these lesson plans, wherein I am elucidating this lesson plan to some other people who had already signed up. Okay. So probably from there also, you can take some pointers. I'll just show you, because see, the point is like this. You need to first know what you don't know. That is the first step to learn something, right? Before you come to know the entire detail, you need to know what you don't know. If you don't know what you don't know, then how will you learn? So any journey is from unknown unknown to known unknown. Then the known unknown should become known known, right? So from that perspective, you can click here the videos. Videos you can go through anyway. I have done on multiple topics, but then I just wanted to tell certain things selectively. 1 minute, yeah. See here, lesson plan. This particular thing, level one lesson plan, you can click on this video. It is 1 hour and 4 minutes video. And then you can just go through what are all the different topics which we are covering. Similarly, here we have a level two, and here we have a level three. Apart from this, I have something called the Agile 4Ps. 4Ps means project, program, portfolio, and the product management. So the way the mentorship program runs is, it will be a hybrid model. Certain things will be recorded sessions. I will share the real-time templates, and then people will go through the recordings and the templates. Then they come to me during the weekend for a orientation class to clear your doubts or clarifications. Because it's not that I am going to block your time and then teach you everything right from the beginning. It has been neatly organized into recorded packs. I will also share the real-time templates. You can use both the recordings and the templates parallelly, because recordings will give you the techniques and the templates will be like a tools. For you to do your work, you need both tools and the techniques, right? So we came up with that particular model. And already I think in level one, for the past 1 year, I have not crossed 100, but 93, 94 people have completed a level one, okay? And in level two, it is 10 or 11. Level three, which is an advanced course, so we have only 3 or 4. Okay, I think 4, because for 3 people it is completed, and for 1 person it is partially going. And for Agile 4Ps, till now people completed, 15, 16 people have completed. But much of the people will sign up for a Scrum Master and a team level Agile coaches. So you can go through the website, you can go through these things, and then come back to me if you are interested to join my mentorship program. And one more important thing is, this is the discount code what I have for people who are joined this particular webinar. I'm just putting the code here. You can just copy it and save it in a notepad and then keep it. But then before enrolling in any of the mentorship program, you may need to connect with me. I will have a conversation with you people. I'll understand your real needs. Okay, so that I can even customize it slightly. Okay, so these are all some of the things which I wanted to tell. Okay, so we can wrap up this session so that I can also go out for a dinner. All right. Hope the session added value to you people in some angle at least.
Yes, sir. Sir, have I only one query?
Hello.
Yeah,
Rajeshwari, tell me.
Sir, actually, we are getting a. Have you handled more than one Scrum team as a Scrum Master at a time? And have you managed to handle it, your time slots? So I need your insight on this, how it needs to be answered.
See, the point is this. I will tell practically, up to three teams we can generally handle as a Scrum Master. Beyond three teams, it will become difficult. More than three teams, see, the experience differs from person to person, okay? From my experience, when I was working as a Scrum Master, I felt comfortable to handle three teams at once. Means, for example, like I used to take turns, Monday, Wednesday, Friday, I will handle I will be part of the ceremonies of one team. Tuesday, Thursday, I will join some other team, something like that. Now, the problem is, the more the teams you are given to actually handle, you can only do facilitation. You cannot do coaching. There is a difference between coaching and the facilitation. Coaching is enabling the people's potential to improve their performance, to improve their capability to the next level. What we are doing here in the webinar is a kind of a mentoring and coaching. Facilitation is ensuring the mic is ready, ensuring the Trello board is ready, ensuring the Zoom is working fine. So there is a difference between the both, right? So you can tell in the interview. See, what you need to tell in the interview, already it has been given in the JD. If the JD says, should have been coached maximum up to three or four teams simultaneously, then from an appropriateness angle, you need to tell what the JD says. Now, the only thing what I'm trying to do here is, let us not fake things. We will really improve the capability and then we will tell, so that what we tell becomes a reality. Okay. So just to cut a long story short, or to cut the cheese, the answer is, you can tell that, like, I have coached three teams comfortably. Beyond three teams, it is becoming more of a facilitation rather than a coaching. That's it. Don't prolong the answer.
Yes, got it. Thank you very much.
Yeah. See, now you think practically, no. See, leave aside the interview. Now you think practically. Monday to Friday, everyone has only 24 hours in their day. And let's say we are working 8 hours for the office. Okay. If they give you more than three teams, will you be able to do justice? Mostly no. See, I was working as a program level coach long back. When I was working as a program level coach, number of teams reporting to me or I need to coach is 21 teams. For the entire program, no, I was a single guy. Now what happened is, since there was 21 teams, I will never go and coach the team members. I will coach the product owners, the scrum masters, and we also had a team level agile coaches who are shared across multiple teams. So me as a program level coach or an integration coach, I will coach product owner, scrum master, and the RTE and the team level coaches. These people will go intern and then do the coaching to the respective teams. Because you cannot expect one coach to coach approximately eight, right? So how many people I can coach, right? That is one way to do. Then there is something called a hard touch versus a soft touch. Soft touch means I no need to coach the team fully. I just need to be part of their ceremonies and then try to plug the gaps. Whereas hard touch is a team where I need to be in the meetings and do some coaching. So the moment you are getting more teams, first try to understand the agile maturity level of these teams and then create a logical grouping. Okay, these teams need more coaching from me, so I need to spend time more here. Whereas these teams need a relatively lesser coaching. Like that, you may need to bifurcate it. By the way, Rajeshwari, you have anyway signed up for our L1 AMP, no? Sometime back?
Yes, sir.
So as part of that five mentoring sessions, what I committed to you, you can actually bring up all these questions. Of course, post you complete the recording.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
All right, yeah. Good luck to all of you and cheers then. We can wind it up.
Good night, sir. Thank you.
Thanks, Balaji. Bye. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Thanks, Balaji.
Sure. Keep in touch. Bye.
Thank you.
Sure. Bye.